Ja. Tag.
One more excellent talk coming here, building modular software with OSGI. Wolf Hildebrandt is from SAP. He's a chief development architect there. And
yes, I will introduce myself then. That's okay. So, so maybe I will introduce first of all myself. So I work at SAP, like already announced, and I started there 14 years ago or something like that. So really as a developer, and then over the time I get more responsibility for in the Java part. So I was heavily involved when SAP adopted Eclipse somehow. So I was starting there with the Eclipse 2 version already. So before it was really OSGI and so on. But then over the time, I become also then somehow responsible for really also the Java server parts of it. So really the JE parts. And then we discussed it before the session a little bit. So there was a Java foundation, and then there were a lot of components on top of it. And this whole thing, this whole Java server was called somehow then the SAP NetWeaver. It's a code name, so similar like WebSphere or whatever. So I think this is also when I was also joining the session in the morning from Ian Robinson. So he was talking about the WebSphere server and what experience they have made with OSGI and how they have built it. So I was really listening to the session, and I think my session is really somehow similar. I also explained somehow over the years how it evolved and what we are doing and how to modularize our software and how we also check that. So this is also one scope of that. So, and the last line is also somehow important because now I'm coming a little bit more into this on-demand area, so where we have new infrastructure. I think this was also, I've joined sessions yesterday, so OSGI and cloud also becomes now also coupled a little bit together, and you also see this also in my presentation. So I will not invest so much about the mechanics of this presentation, but I will start with the problem statement. So I will focus on two aspects of this modularization topic in OSGI, and especially when you talk about Java somehow. So the first thing that I would like to start with is a very famous analysis that was done by Structure 101 guys. So maybe for those who do not know the Structure 101 tool, this is an architecture check tool. So I think you can there somehow analyze an existing code base, or you can also define some model how the architecture of this of the new product or new software should be. So, and they have used it for analysis of find bugs. So find bugs is there to find bugs in existing codes. So they use this tool. And this is a very famous analysis. I simply want to point it out to explain why modularization is really important and to show you one aspect. So this is the find bugs version 0.7.2. You see it, everything is fine. So it's very small. You have some packages that reference each other. So and now over the time, there are more packages, more dependencies to it, so it's very well known. And now, I think with this version, they're now starting somehow with introducing a cycle in this between the packages. And for those who are familiar with this modularity topic, if you introduce a cycle, you have a really big problem because then the coding is coupled. So this means you cannot, cannot split it, you cannot decouple it, and this is somehow the root of all evil. And what you see there at the beginning, it's not so big. So you see it. But what is now very interesting is that this tangle is now somehow evolving. And you see it here, the version number, it's 1.0.0. So it's really the 1.0 version. And there you see really a big tangle. So I have not counted the packages inside that, but I would assume that there are more packages inside this tangle that are outside. So this means that this code base of this whole thing really got somehow coupled together, so it's really somehow one big monolithic block. And this also evolves further, so it becomes bigger and bigger, and at the final end, you nearly have all these coding inside, and this is somehow also, I think I've seen it yesterday when there was this big box of monolithic code. So The problem with that is now that if you now want to extend this framework, it is rather difficult to do, because this was also the statement from outside. So you have many points where you have to plug in if you want to have a new checker in this Findbox infrastructure. So it's really somehow not maintainable. And this is one aspect of modularity and the problem statement. So if you do not control your code base somehow, you get a problem that you are evolving into a monolithic block, and you really have a architecture erosion. This is the term in it. So this is the architecture erosion topic in it. So basic question is, how can you control your software? How can you structure it? And how can you do that? OK, now I would also focus on a second aspect of this of the modularization of software is, so if you want now to analyze a server, I have now taken this NetWeaver server that I was talking about before. So it's similar to this WebSphere server that Ian was talking about in the morning. Java server. So, and similar to Ian, SAP also started now to analyze this code base and find out what were the dependencies between that to really have control over the server. And so I think Ian was talking about 10 million lines of code. I'm not sure how many million lines of code we were having to control, but what you see there is also, so in contrast to the Structure 101 tooling you see here, SAP and an analysis tool has not only packages, so like you know from Java, they have had also the need to introduce somehow higher level software structuring entities. So here they are called software components and maybe even software usage types. And this means many packages are included in one software component, and many software components are part of one usage type. So this is simply a structure hierarchy. This is you will also see this when I talk about OSGI, how is this then reflected there. But this SAP NetWeaver is, I don't know how many years, also 10 years or so. Sorry. So, and this means, how does it now look like? So what you see here are the, this is the highest level. So for example, you see here the JE part. So this is really the Java server that you know maybe. Can I use that? Okay, but what you see here, so the Java server part, so the JE part is one aspect. And you have many usage types on top of it. For example, you have here at the top, you have there somehow like a BPM engine. You have here a portal somewhere, a business intelligence solution, something like this, like that. So this means a really huge software product. So if you only analyze this by packages or so, hilft mir wohl nicht. So if you only analyze this by packages, I don't know. These are then maybe millions of packages, and you cannot analyze that. So this means the second aspect of modularization that I would like to talk about that is you need hierarchies. So this means you cannot have a flat structure of packages somehow where you then say, now I would like to control the dependencies between the packages. This is simply not enough for really a big product. So this is an aspect. So if you drill down here, for example, you see also then here somehow, so this was the JE scenario, the usage type I was talking about before. Then you have here the software components inside. They have also dependencies. And you see also, what you see then also here is that are also then the numbers of dependencies are also counted, for example. Here you see a number. Is there a pointer? Is there a pointer, by the way? Okay, doesn't matter. So, what you see here, so you need then the hierarchy. So this is the second aspect or the second problem statement. So first aspect, architecture will erode. Second problem statement is you need hierarchies in your architecture, so or in your check to analyze the modularization of that. So now the goals. So I think I will skip that because of timing reasons. So the goals, I think it's very obvious. So what you would like to achieve is I would like to have an extensible framework or an extensible server, and you also would like to substitute the modules. So this means you have an existing server and you simply want to add another module. So this means the errors here are somehow the interfaces that should be clear, that should be defined, and so on and so forth. Or the other thing where you would like to replace something, you would like to use another module to replace it with an existing one. So these are the real two goals that you would like, that you have. So what does it now mean? So now I would like to explain how this relates now to this OSGI. So I usually call this somehow the hello world example of modularization. Oh, man. So what you see here is there are a lot of bundles, and this is nothing more than a web application. And if I now let use this application, you will see here that you have data. So this is really an artificial Hello World application for modularization. You see here some data coming from the US, some data is coming from France, some data is coming from Germany. Everything is fine. If you now take a look at the list of bundles, so I think you're all familiar with OSGI, so very well known. So you see here there's a data aggregator that aggregates the data. You see also here somehow the data sources. And especially this data source 3 means if you now stop, for example, this data source 3, so this is ID 2, so now this is stopped. You see it's resolved. If I now do a refresh here, the data from the US is gone. So this is a very well-known thing, so everybody knows that, and I think this is the real goal of modularization, that you really can do that. So, so now I come to the heart of my presentation. So you have to define your modularity. So to achieve really the thing that I've shown before, that you really start your bundles, can stop them, and so on and so forth. So the first thing that you have to do is you have to select a modular runtime. So this is usually a Java talk, so they have to convince the people for OSGI. I think this is not required here in this round. So modular runtime is somehow set. This is this is OSGI, so Equinox or Felix or whatever. Then you need somehow the definition of the modules. So in this case, what I've shown before, these are simply the bundles. I will say something after that to modules a little bit more. Then you have to do the decoupling and the coding. So this means you have to apply these architecture patterns. I will also skip this in this talk because I think these are somehow, how do you decouple? So for example, facades or factories or whatever. So I think you have to apply that to really have there really a separation of implementation and interface. So I think this was also shown yesterday, where you end up then with the usual pattern that you have one bundle that represents the interface and another bundle that is for the implementation. So this is a well known pattern, so nothing really so difficult. And then, the third step here is this active definition of the system. So you have seen this in my screenshot when I was talking about the subnet Viva server. So this means there you have to really actively define which usage types I have, and also which software components, and so on and so forth. So I really have to do an active definition of the system. So to really say, the architect is to say, the system should look like this. You will also see this later in the presentation. I call this to be picture. So because, so this is the picture how it should be, so the to be picture. And what I can also do is then I have to measure it. So this means I have a to be picture, and now I have to compare it with the current architecture that is implemented in code. And then I have to see and also maybe apply some metrics to that. And then I have to see if my architecture really fits to the implementation, rework something, refactor it, and so on and so forth. And the very important thing for this is you also have to do a definition of the modules again. So because in real life, what you can also see is that sometimes the teams that are doing then this modularization, they are very doing a very fine granular design of bundles. And so this means they are defining for one interface, one bundle, and then also somehow then have then also another implementation bundle. So you end up then also with, so I think yesterday it was somehow the bundle hell somehow that you have there 1,000 bundles and so on and so forth. And this is simply, this is a question how fine-grained this should be. So, but sometimes the bundles are there, but you have to decouple them. So this is the cycle that you usually have to do in your development process. So now the big question is, this is fine and cool, but how can you really support that, or how can this be done really in the active development? I will also skip the basic parts of the OSGI component model. So I think this thing I know, you know, so I will skip that. This is the lifecycle model versus what are the advantages of modules. Okay. But I was talking about this hierarchy of modularization. So this means you have a bundle. And in the core OSGI model or in the specifications, you simply have the bundles. But so this is the reason why I say it's somehow really similar to the talk that Ian has done in the morning. So he was also talking about the subsystem specification. So what does it now mean? Subsystems are bundling the bundles together. So this means you're not having bundle as a flat hierarchy level. You can also group the bundles into higher subsystems, and these subsystems you can also group them together. And this means you can really control there, because if you really have a big product like this NetWeaver thing, where you have there, I don't know, 20 million lines of code, and then you have then maybe, I don't know, 2,000 bundles, these 2,000 bundles can never be checked in one diagram by one guy, because this is it's a wallpaper. Nobody can really control that. And the answer, from my understanding, or well, something that could really help there, is this OSGI subsystem specification. So the subsystem is similar. So this is taken from a block. You see it there at the bottom, so you can follow this on your own. But the basic principle is you have there some bundles, so bundles C and D or A and B on this side, and they are part of the subsystem, but they also share another bundle. So this means you can also say these bundles are there, you can also have references, so the subsystem is similar to a bundle, but on a higher level, because it's simply grouping other bundles. So, and this gives you then the flexibility that you can also define the modularization of a bigger product and not only of a simple web application. So there I have also a demo. Also the demo of that. So you see here A and B shared and so on and so forth. I will start it. So what you see here is there. So if I now will display the list of subsystems, you see there's no subsystem in. If I now do an installation of that, so now I install. So now if I do the same, so you see one is installed. So this is the same life cycle like for an OSGI bundle. Dot install file dot plugin. So now there's a second one installed. Okay, fine. If I now go on, and if I now start one of them, so I now start subsystem one. If I now see this list of subsystems, one is started, so active. You see subsystem one is started. If you now take a look one level below, so at the real bundles, you see there, so here is bundle A and bundle B. They are now active, and the shared bundle is also started. So this means it is one level above, and you can control it, you can see it, you can ask the runtime, what subsystems do you have, and you can control that. The other bundles here for C and D, for the other subsystems, they are not started. If I now also start this one, for example, see it's installed. If I now say subsystem.start.2, then also all the bundles will be started. So you see, everything is now started, and this means OSGI provides me then also with the newest specification of subsystem. It provides me a solution for this hierarchy problem that I have. So this means I can now also specify the different hierarchy levels, because subsystems can also be nested. And this means I can not only model somehow a small web application with 20, 30, 40 bundles or so, I can really go on to real enterprise servers and so on and so forth. So I can really use that. So from my understanding, this is one of the big things that was missing in the OSGI part to really modularize it. And now you see it here. It is possible now. So I will also, so. Now, so I will skip this decoupling part because this is, from my understanding, this is somehow development. Yeah, this is development, Java development, as you know it. So for example, you have to apply the principles like so the Gang of Four patterns, for example, facade. So a module should have a clear interface. You all know that. So for example, in a bundle, you have exported packages, and this is the clear interface of this bundle. So I think this is somehow well known. But what I would like to stress a little bit more is this active definition of a system. So what you see here. So from the inner to the outer, so you have the packages, the Java packages. Then around that, you have the module. So maybe you can say it's a bundle. And then you have the subsystems. You see it here. This is in the next level. So you have the subsystems I have shown before. So you have seen OSGI specification. You get really support from the specification, from OSGI itself, for the subsystems. Then, for sure, you also have there somehow system layers. So you should layer your architecture, also very, very basic. And then you have the system that runs on the platform. So these are somehow then the entities that you should have in mind. So this is the web application that you have seen before in the demo. So for example, at the bottom, what you see here are the different data sources. So data source 3, 2, and 1. We have here also the data source interface. It's also separated by another bundle, as I have explained before. And on top of it, you have then also the UI parts. And then also here in the middle, you have then also some of the data aggregators. So these are then the layers. These are the different bundles that you have there. So this is then really somehow, this is created with the Structure 101 tool. So one of the tools that we are using. And so this is generated based on the code base. So this is really a picture that this is showing the as-is architecture. So this means it shows you really how this is done. So now I'm coming to the other important part, so focusing on the problem definition of the first thing, so architecture erosion. How can you now avoid that you have these tangles in your architecture, that you avoid the cycles? The first thing that you have to do is you have to define the to-be picture. So as you can see here, I have done this in a PPT. So this is, if you want to present the architecture to someone, this is good because you can present in a PPT and so on. This is okay. But the problem is you create this at one point in time. And if you develop your product, you definitely have also to check it. And what we have taken there at SAP and used it somehow is a Concat tool. I will also show this there. So we have done intensive analysis of the tools or so, which one should we take. So we have taken also Concat because it's extensible. It's open source. You can contribute there. For example, you can definitely also provide, for example, modularity metrics. So for example, how coupled is a bundle? So is it how much two bundles are connected and so on and so forth. So this you can implement there. This is not possible in Structure 101 because it's a commercial tool and they are not focusing on the OSGI aspect so much. So this is the difference. So now I also would like to show you how this looks like. So what you see here is, so this is the same diagram that you have also seen in the in the PPT. But this time there's a difference that you can say here, there's a data source. Now you see here a mapping. So what does it mean? There's now data source 1.jar. So this means that the jar with this name is now mapped to this box in the diagram. And so this is currently in this diagram. This is a one-to-one relation. So this means I have here, for example, I have in the real web application, I have 4 data aggregators, I have 3 data sources, I have 1 bundle for the data source interface, one for the data display, and so on and so forth. So this is a very, it's a very simple or primitive application. So here you don't need these hierarchies, as you can see. But if we now go to a little bit more complex architecture, so this is now the architecture of a product, of a real product. So as you can see, you have more boxes. So, and you also see that the dependencies are somehow going from the top to the bottom. So this is really a layered architecture. And the important thing for, that is really important is, coming back to the subsystem thing is, here the mapping. So there are two bundles included. Maybe I find also another thing. So as you see here, so this is really, these are really subsystems that, that are modeled here. So this box here has five jars, so five bundles. And this means you are grouping them and really couple them together. And you also see that there's also, this is also layered. So this is really somehow conforming to the thing that I have said before, that so I have layers, I have subsystems, and I also, so you, it's also indicated by this green color that these are the allowed dependencies. I can also now run a check against the code base that I have, and if now someone introduces a dependency between two subsystems or bundles, then I get also an indicator in the build result. So this could be an error and so on and so forth. So this is also then clearly identified. Maybe I also point out here something here that you see also here. So, so this is a box that does not have a dependency to the bottom. And now you can now ask, why does the thing not have a dependency to the bottom? This is maybe related to the thing that I and Robin, Robinson has explained in the morning, because he has said, so what do you want to do if you want to migrate from, from an existing product that is not OSGI compliant to a new stack? You simply take this whole big thing and move it there into one bundle and put it to the server and let it run there. And this is then the consequence, how it looks like then in the diagram, because this thing does even not use somehow real OSGI APIs, because it's not, it's doing the class loading on its own, for example, and this requires then the refactoring. It runs in the server, but it's doing the class loading somehow on its own, so it's not really OSGI compliant, but it runs there inside the server. And you see it here directly because it looks like a, yeah, like an alien in this diagram, because all the other things are somehow, they have dependencies, they're also used in OSGI frameworks at the bottom, so they are somehow really integrated in the whole server. And even on this level of when you say, how does the modularization in this server looks like, it looks like something that really does not belong to this server. So you see it also there. So, so this was then the demo with the with another server from SAP. I will shortly also say something about this measurement of modular software. So maybe I really start with, with the demo. So what we have also somehow, we have done some research is, so we were thinking about the metrics. So how can you measure, for example, you have two bundles, and now you have to find out how coupled are these two bundles. So if you find out, so similar to the analysis that I've shown in the, from the NetWeaver server before, if you have there somehow a number of dependencies between these two bundles of 1,000 or whatever, you really find out that, these two things are so tightly coupled that they should be to, should belong together. So this is then the thing that, okay, either you have done a mistake, then you have to think about how many dependencies there are, or you have to bring it to one bundle because it does not make sense to have it in two bundles. So, and this means we are thinking about the coupling. So this means, these are formulas. I think they're anyhow on the home, on the web page of this conference, so I think you can take a look at them. I think you can also Google and do this Googling. So, but this first thing, so the coupling, so the I is CE dot CE plus CE, CA plus CE. So this means, what is the relation between the usages of the exported types compared to the number of use types? So you see it here. So, and if you find out that, that this number is somehow, The more components this component depends upon, the more unstable it is. So this means if there is, for example, it has 1,000 dependencies, so to other classes, I think then this thing is really somehow unstable, because if two of them changes, this thing is, so one of this changes, another one changes, the next development cycle, so this is somehow really shaky. So this means you have really think about how decoupled this bundle really is. So this is really an important part. So now coming to the demo part. So if I now open this tool, so this is now the result of a check that is done in the build. And now if I now go to the architecture check, you see it, it's a usual web application, it's a usual homepage. You see here all the modularization details in it. So for example, you see here the what is now interesting, I was talking about the relation between the components that are using the thing and also somehow the dependencies to the bottom. This thing is not used by anyone. So this means the factor for that is zero. So this is available for this one. So you see it here. It's a big diagram. So as you see it here, so you can really deep dive there in detail what it really means. So I would like to come to the summary. So key takeaways are, so big software systems have to be structured, but more high level than packages. So this is the thing that I was talking about before. And OSGI supports you there with the subsystems. So you really get some help directly from the specification. The next key takeaway is that you should use an iterative process to structure software during the whole lifecycle of the product. So this means you cannot do a one shot and say, this is now the architecture. You have really to check this, and you have to also use some tools for that. Because if you always, if you are the poor architect, and you always have to analyze the whole code base of a big product, you start with it, and then after 1 month or so, you can directly start at the beginning, right from the beginning, and do it again. So you will never come to a final thing. Then the implementation best practices support some of the modularity. So I think it's also worth to take a look at that, even on a higher level thing. So for example, dependency injection. I think there was many talks about declarative services, blueprints, and so on and so forth. It's very important also to use this one. Services, OSGI services for sure. And the modularity can also be measured and can also be somehow analyzed. This is also one of the key takeaways. So it's not something like magic or so that you say it's somehow an art. How to do that, you can also find out if something is good. So if something is coupled or it's not decoupled or so, you really can find it out. And also there are some criteria for that. Okay. With that, thank you very much.
Do we have any questions?
Package levels, so it's a Java coding. So Maven, so I think this is always so. So the Maven and OSGI are somehow, so they both define dependencies, and so it's a question that where you take a look at, and we have decided that we really take a look at the OSGI part, so really at the runtime part. Other questions? Which one?
The proposed modularity in Java 9, Project Jigsaw.
Ah, Jigsaw. From my understanding, so I have also read the announcement only somehow, and Jigsaw does not have focused so much on the versioning. So so I think it's Jigsaw is somehow the it's opposite to OSGI, I would say. Somehow focus not so much about that. But I don't know. Do you know somehow the status of Jigsaw? I have heard that it's even postponed now.
Well, subsets, strict subsets of SC. So Compact 2 is a superset. that does is it provides SE basically multiple size footprints. And then this is just my opinion, that removes a lot of the necessity for fully modularizing the JDK itself. Jigsaw itself has changed. If you look at Mark Reinhold's blog, the proposal has actually been changing and evolving. I think we won't really know what it's going to look like until Java 8 is out the door, because I think there's been some rethinking going on. Importantly, I think OSGI, the JDK has a footprint. It's going to have smaller footprint with the compact profiles if you need smaller footprints. But really, the big use of modularity is often at the application level. And clearly, OSGI addresses that need. It's a very mature technology with subsystems that's really become very flexible. And like Ian Robinson was talking, when you have to modularize 10 million lines of code, the size of an SE JDK almost is a rounding error, you know, in the size of the footprint. So I think it's a wait and see on Java 9. That's not an official IBM position. I've been watching it for many, many years, and it continues to evolve. And so, as I said, personally, I'm going to wait till after Java 8's out the door and in people's hands before I conclude anything about Java 9.
Yeah, same with me. So, for example, if you take a look at OSGI, so OSGI provides a foundation, and they have even specifications on top of it. For example, with the subsystems or so, they are filling the holes somehow. So it's somehow, or the gaps that are there. So from my understanding, it's mature, much more mature. So
yeah, more mature, and it's got a service layer, and you know, it's got a dynamic lifecycle design. As you probably know, I'm also with IBM. They couldn't have done what they did to WebSphere without the full set of layering that OSGI has. And I haven't seen any proposal from Jigsaw that has complete feature list, right? So we'll see. We'll see what happens.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay.
Okay.
Thanks.